Good evening. My name is Ashok Gurung, one of the directors at India-China Institute. First thing I want to do is really thank you all for joining us this evening for a very, I think it's a special evening because many of us have been involved in this part of the world, part of the conversation that we sometimes refer to as Kailash conversation. Sometimes we call it by Kangrimpoche, sometimes we even refer it to Tise. It's the same name for the same mountain. And it all began with a fairly straightforward set of questions that emerged out of our earlier project called Everyday Religion and Sustainable Environments in the Himalaya. And basically, we wanted to know a bit more about the relationship between religion and ecology, culture and ecology in the Himalaya, and especially around this very important mountain called Mount Kailash. That's the most, well-known name of this area. As a place, it's really, to me, it was most fascinating because it's a shared sacred landscape. It's important to Hindus, and you know there are many of them. Hindus, Buddhists refer to this mountain as Kangrimpoche, Bompos, and these are animists, pre-Buddhist and Buddhist tradition in Tibetan areas. And also Jains and Sikhs, they also find this particular place very important to their way of thinking, their cosmology. So we really wanted to understand this relationship. What does it tell us about both our past, our present, and our future? So that's how we began this conversation, and we wanted to assemble a group of people from India, China, Nepal, and the US. And we got very lucky, a very interesting group of about 20 or so scholars and experts joined us in this journey over the past 3 years. And here I just want to thank Luce Foundation and my good friend and former colleague, Toby Wokman, who will make a brief remarks in a bit, for Luce Foundation for really supporting this project. And also thanks to the New School that really in many ways made this kind of project possible. And of course, many people, whether it's really porters, villagers, or experts, officials, so many people really made this exploration, this study, this journey possible. And what you're seeing in the on the screen is really some of the images. Over the past 3 years, I think I spent probably more than 100 days in the region, walking and learning from people, learning about the region. It was simply one of those most fascinating experience that I have had. I think tonight what we wanted to do is three things, basically. One is to have you experience a bit of what this idea of shared sacred landscape really meant to many of us, those who were part of this conversation. Through our exhibit, and the exhibit was primarily curated, led by my colleague Rit Premnath and Chris Cruz, and of course they were assisted by several other colleagues. So I just want to formally thank both Rit and Chris for curating this exhibit. So I hope those of you who came, just a few minutes ago, if you have time, after the presentation is over, I hope you will have a chance to walk around and experience a bit of what we, did and we learned from. The second thing I wanted to do is really focus tonight more on inviting some of the colleagues from the New School. These colleagues, many of them, or several of them actually, they were new to Himalaya. But what I found interesting about their own scholarship was really they were also wrestling with, and they were also interested in the kind of questions that started to really work with. We have Rafi Yuvat, who teaches at the NSSR. Mark Larimore, he's actually someone that who was also part of the earlier project. And I think, Mark, you and I are the one of the few people who went to Kailash twice, right? Rit, who teaches at the Parsons School of Design, an artist. Nitin, who teaches at the Media Studies program at NSPE, a new school for public engagement. Chris, who is a PhD student, has been really part of the ICI, India-China Institute, for quite some time. So what we wanted to do is really have them share a bit about their experience. What is it that they found interesting? What is it that they are working on? And how did this particular engagement shape their own scholarship and also their teaching here at the new school? So I think that's the second objective of our evening together. The third really is to tell you by sharing some of the insights is to also tell you that this project, in many ways, while it's coming to an end in terms of the project phase, we still have plans to find ways to really engage with this concept of what can one learn by looking at religion ecology intersection, and for that towards the end of April, from April 20th through 23rd, right, we have a major international conference here at the new school called Mountains and Sacred Landscapes. So I hope I'll see most of you at that conference. It's really going to bring an amazing group of scholars and experts from all over the world, not just scholars who work on Himalaya. So I think that would be yet another opportunity for people to really wrestle with some of these ideas that we have been working with. And then I think as we move forward, we want to tell you that some of the work that we have done is going to be curated in an online space. And Chris Cruz will talk about that a bit. And the idea is really a project like this, I think while it might appear very remote, very in some ways inaccessible in terms of getting there. But I think what we learned over the past 3 years is there is much one can learn from about our contemporary questions and debates around whether it's climate change, whether it's notions of how do you find balance between competing demands on what people, the material demands that people have versus ecological considerations that one has to pay attention to. And these are some of the things that we encountered while we spent time in the region. Many people, while they still retain and want to celebrate and work with some of the ideas that have been there for many, many generations, yet there are people in or around Mount Kailash, they will pick up their phone and they will talk to a relative who is located somewhere in Queens or somewhere in Paris or in Beijing or Delhi or Kathmandu. So in a way, this area is on one hand very, very remote, but at the same time very, very connected to the rest of the world. So issues of technology, mobility, all of these ideas really in some ways form some interesting set of questions that I believe my colleagues have found them very interesting, and as a result of that, I think, a lot of interesting outcomes, whether it's really academic papers, whether it's policy type, you know, position papers, including a book, several books really focused on curating and telling stories from the region, you know, folk stories or from the region that also highlight some of the central questions that we wrestle with. So I think these are really broadly three things: celebrating the exhibit artists' perspective on sacred landscapes, listening from my colleagues about their experience, and third, really to tell you that this project continues, and we invite each one of you, you know, to really stay engaged with this work that we got very fortunate to have wonderful support from the New School and Lewis Foundation. So on that note, I will stop here, and I'll ask, maybe before I move to my colleagues, maybe Toby, would you mind saying a few words, please? Toby, by the way, was at one point, you know, the a deputy provost at the New School, so she's really a New School person also.
Please. Thank you. Hi, everyone. Actually, my time at the New School coincided with the beginning of the India-China Institute, so it's always wonderful for me to come back here and over the years to see how it's evolved and grown and done amazing things under Ashok's leadership and with all of you. So I will be very brief, but I just wanted to give a couple of words of context about the Luce Foundation and why we support this. As many people ask me what the Luce Foundation does, and it works largely in higher education. It's probably best known for its Asian studies programs. But about 10 years ago or 12 years ago, a new initiative was launched on religion and international affairs to try to help policymakers and the general public better understand the complexities of religion and a whole range of world issues. To date, we've made about 150 grants. I was trying to count them earlier. It's something like that. For support of universities, policy organizations, media producers, collaborations across those three. And the idea of collaboration is very crucial. Pretty much everything we do tries to encourage either interdisciplinary, cross-regional, other kinds of collaboration, and particularly collaboration across the academy to the policy world, and often that's done through various kinds of media projects. So from the beginning, the initiative included work on religion and development, but it actually wasn't until Ashok came to me some, I don't know, 6-7 years ago, that we began to support work linking religion and ecology, religion and environment. And I'm happy to say there's been a bit of an uptick in that. We also have a grant to American University, which is doing interesting comparative work on religious responses to climate change. It's more focused on climate change, but it's more global in scope. And it also includes this part of the world and the Andes. The exhibit tonight reflects the commitment, I think, of the India-China Institute to really push the boundaries of the kinds of collaborations entailed, including with the arts, which is a fairly new thing, or experimental thing, at least for the Luce Foundation. And it wasn't actually part of the original game plan, and it's been fun to see it evolve and expand in these creative ways. And in the last couple of years, I've also been able to make grants to other kinds of organizations doing more experimental visual work. So for example, we fund the Magnum Foundation, which some of you may be familiar with Magnum Photography, for collaborative projects that are initiated by documentary photographers, but bring together scholars, journalists, and other kinds of folks in conceptualizing new ways of telling stories about religion. So Luce is very happy to have been able to support the India-China Institute and this initiative in particular for all sorts of reasons, including the focus on this part of the world, which is so neglected, and these issues, which I think just need more attention. And in closing, I would say, just to remind us all, although we don't need this reminder, particularly at a moment when in this country support for work in the arts, the humanities, and science, and thinking about climate change is kind of drastically under threat. So thank you, Ashok, and all of you. And just one other thing, if you look at the Luce Foundation website in the coming weeks, occasionally we have a grant spotlight which describes in more detail one of our projects, and the next one up is Sacred Landscapes, so check it out. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, Toby. I think now, basically, I'll ask. It's kind of hard, you know, to tell my colleagues and you know, educators. If you give them platform, we can talk for hours and hours. And especially for a project like this, it's just such an amazing experience to just. I felt bad to ask them. Say, you have about 7 minutes to really tell us a bit about, you know, your experience. And I think I know that they probably. I think that I'm crazy, but I wanted to make sure that we, get to hear from them, but also have enough time to at least have some exchange, you know, towards the end, even if it's just comments from, you know, you. I think that would be useful. So the order is: Chris is going to go first, then Mark, then Nitin, Rafi, and Rit. Does that sound good? Please, Chris.
How's everybody doing this evening? So we'll see if I can jump back into the slideshow for just 1 minute. There's a few things that I wanted to highlight here for folks. So one of the things that I think is really important about this project, and at least what I've been involved in, is trying to make sense of this region. So this map you're looking at here is basically the project area that we've been working in. So where you see these little pink feet here, it's a bit like our experience. It's ephemeral. It's always changing. The pink feet you see here are essentially the different areas where we've been traveling through and where other pilgrims have been traveling through in the region. And it's important for two reasons, because much of what we've been doing, I'll let this play through in the background, is trying to make sense of when you're traveling through Nepal, India, and Tibet in these kind of high mountain areas. These have been important areas for centuries, generations, maybe even millennia. And part of my task as a graduate student here in politics, but also working with the India-China Institute, is to think about how do we take this content and the experiences, so fieldwork, research notes, photos, video, interviews, sketches, oral traditions, and the group's experiences on this trip, and put that into some sort of collective archive that can live on beyond just the 1 or 2 or 3 years of the research project. But also, as Ashok mentioned, as part of the project doing folk stories, how to keep some of this information for long-term use. So in many of the areas, we were talking to elderly storytellers who in another 20 or 30 years will be gone, and their stories and that oral knowledge will be gone. So how do you capture that kind of information and stories? And the storybooks that we're working on is one part of that. Audio and video recordings is another one. And the challenge for me in this mapping sacred landscapes, which is one part of the project that Ashok kind of mentioned and I've been focusing on the last 3 years, is how do we put all this content together into some kind of a coherent, organized way so that we can use it, other scholars can use it, we can present it to the Luce Foundation when they ask, hey, what did you do with all that money we gave you over the last couple years? Or when the president says, so what is the India-China Institute doing these days? You know, we can say, well, we're doing A and B and C, and you can go to this website, or you can pick up this book, or you can talk to this person, or you can come next door and look at the exhibit going on. And the challenge, as you're seeing in all these different photos, is how do you take 3 years of an experience and condense it into a coherent narrative? Because it's very difficult. For those of you that either are from the region or have traveled at all, particularly in the high mountain areas, the experience there is something that it's hard to describe if you haven't been there firsthand. Going over 5 or 6,000 meter peaks is not something you can just kind of tell someone. You have to actually gasp for a bit of oxygen if you're not native to that height and get a sense of what it's like to be freezing, to be interacting, to be showing pictures to people, and to be in places that you've never seen before and seem in some ways a bit mystical or fantastic in terms of the landscapes. And I think for me as a researcher, originally I was interested in pop culture and zombies in the Anthropocene. And now I'm writing about land rights in Nepal in the 1800s. So in a way, getting involved in these research projects, not only is it sort of my day job at the Institute, but it's changed the way I think about my research and the way, at least as a PhD student, I've tried to bring in issues of people living on the land, issues of rights, issues of justice, issues of constitutional politics. For those of you that know the region, there's always a lot that's changing and going on. And how we make sense of that is part of the challenge of the story. And whether we're doing that visually, as you're seeing here, another component you'll see a little bit of here later on, is trying to put these into maps. So I've been doing a variety of ArcGIS mapping, OpenStreet mapping, using story mapping projects to try to put video and audio and text together into kind of interactive environments. One of our audience guests here tonight from Antidote Games, we've been working with a couple of folks there to try to develop an interactive online app about what would it be like if you were going on a pilgrimage to Kailash, and to give someone the ability to spend 5 or 7 minutes pretending like they're experiencing this trip, and what are the things they might see and the obstacles and the decisions they might have to make, to try to think about the different ways that we could interact and meet people. The storybooks Ashok mentioned is another one. So we're producing, at the end of the day, it'll be, I believe, 5 different books. One will be a collection of stories that an Indian and Nepali author rewrote. So we had original folk stories that were maybe a page, and now they've become 10 or 12 or 15 pages elaborated based on kind of local myths from the region. And then others, so over the course of 3 years, we had researchers out in the field collecting stories. So we might have 1 or 2 pages of a story from somewhere in western Tibet or in the mountains of Nepal about how 2 rocks are actually fish, and a story about how those fish swam up the stream in the Karnali River in western Nepal, and at one point stopped, and they turned into rocks. And you can see those 2 rocks in the landscape today, and it's part of what we hiked by. But there's a myth that explains why rice stopped there, why Hinduism stops here, and Buddhism starts here. And so there's all these different pieces of the story that are embedded together, and these other books we're working on are part of the way to do that. So they're geared slightly towards a younger audience, so the idea is that you'll be able to pick up a book. It's in English and Nepali, English and Hindi, English and Tibetan, or English and Mandarin Chinese, and reread some of these stories. Maybe you're from the region and you'll be like, oh, I know that story, or that sounds like a story I know. Or you might say, I had no idea about any of these stories. And these are a different way to try to bring all these different experiences together through print media, through online media, through sound. And I think we may get to hear a little bit of the kind of the oral experience from Nitin when he's talking about the soundscapes work he's been doing. So for me, the challenge and the excitement about being involved in this, both as a research project but also as a graduate student here at the New School, is really thinking about how do we expand our conception of our relationship in the world, how we're doing research, but also how we are engaged with a larger community. Because at the end of the day, many of the areas we travel through are poor, food deficit, impoverished areas where coming back to New York, you feel like, well, we have it really great here. And thinking about how do we engage with these issues, not just as scholars and academics, but you know, also personally. Because at the end of the day, at least you know, not speaking for the Institute or the New School, but personally, you know, I think we have a responsibility to think about our political role, how we're interacting in the landscape, whether you're interested from an ethnographic perspective or just a basic trying to be a good human being in a complicated political world. And so to take all this information and stories and research and put it into a way that both tries to speak back with the local community but also tries to expand, you know, more complicated discussions about religion, about ecology, about cultural politics, about ethnic identities, about changing dynamics with development in a region that in the past didn't have a road. And now there's a 2-lane highway that's being built through there. So how do we think about these kind of questions? So for me, I think that's been one of the exciting things about this project is thinking about questions that maybe I wouldn't have been thinking about when I was thinking about The Walking Dead in the Anthropocene. But now it's land rights in Nepal and sacred landscapes in the Himalayas. Thank you.
So one of the fun things about doing interdisciplinary things, which is what we do at the New School all the time, is that you find yourself more disciplinary than you realized you were. So as I was trying to think about what I would say this evening, I found myself falling into the genre of a testimonial, which in religious studies I'm contemptuous of, or study with curiosity, but it is the form it took. So here we go. I don't want to waste more of your time. I was one of those people who was privileged enough to go around Kailash twice. And I am unimaginative enough to have gone around twice in the same direction. So Ashokarun came as well, went once in the clockwise direction that Hindus, Buddhists, and many others take, and then the other time counterclockwise of the bun. I had my reasons for going. Maybe I'll explain them. My mother's German. This is something I grew up with, the phrase that einmal ist keinmal, one time is no time. So having had the luxury of going twice, I'll tell you the first time was a wash. So the first time I went, Kailash had only recently become real to me. When Ashok sat me down in a cafe not far from here and said, would you be interested in going on a circumambulation of Mount Kailash, I thought he was joking, or would have been if he hadn't taken me a few years before to a place called Shangri-La. I thought that Kailash was a mythical mountain. I didn't think there was an actual concrete place that there was, so of course I said yes, even as I thought we couldn't possibly be going there. So Kailash had only recently become real for me when I went the first time. I knew that it loomed large in the religious imaginations of many people, but I had no idea how large it loomed or how it could loom, if it was an actual place that was concrete as well as so mythically important. That time, as you saw on that map that disappeared four times, we took the route across the land, joining the road from Lhasa, and I thought that I saw Kailash at least four times before we got there. There were certain peaks. I had looked at books about this. I'd seen what we were looking for, and I saw these beautiful pyramids, you know, ice pyramids, which is what I was told that a Kailash would look like several times. It was not it. It was not it. When we finally got to one, it looked more like a sheep's head, as you saw there. But this whetted my interest, and I said, what is it about this sheep's head mountain that trumped all these other mountains? Why did this mountain become so important when there are all these other ones that look so much like Kailash? I also had done enough reading to know that in the Buddhist tradition, for example, it is thought that depending on your level of enlightenment, you will see more or less. If you're an adept, you will see a crystal pyramid, a pagoda. If you're not, you'll just see a rock. I saw a rock. The second time I went, with people who are here today, I had a better sense of who I was and where I was going. I had learned more about Kailash. In particular, I had learned that there are other mountains in the Western Himalaya that have been venerated as Mount Kailash. And that this one had only become dominant relatively recently, although there's some controversy about how recent that was. I also knew that there were sort of subsidiary mountains, that there were sort of Kailash-like mountains that were smaller, that were accessible to people in other places, and that that was the main way that most people for whom Kailash was a significant mountain had been accessed. They didn't go to the, whichever one it was in the Western Himalaya that was hard to get to, but one of these other ones that was closer to hand. I had also had the privilege of going by foot through Humla, which is the region in far western Tibet, Nepal, that's one of the traditional pilgrimage routes from India, in a region that may eventually get a paved road but doesn't have it yet. So I was able to experience the Kora walking around Kailash in the context of a culture in which walking is something everybody does all the time. There's nothing special about it. Maybe it's special to walk in a circle. Also, walking along these routes had helped me to understand Kailash as a place on routes of commerce and cultural exchange. It wasn't just this place that was in the center of nowhere. I also had, having read about this some more and reflected on it, a different sense of how it is that Kailash speaks to people today, which is different from the way in which it functioned before. In the past, Kailash was a place nobody could go to, or very few people went, and if they went, it was courting death. They might never come back. It was remote, it was far away, it was off the edge of the map. It was so high up that you couldn't even put it into the picture. Now Kailash is a place many people can go to, and it has a different kind of appeal. For me as a Western person, Kailash is not a marginal place. The Himalayas are not a marginal place, they're a central place. If I imagine a representation of the world, the Himalayas are at the center of it. And if we had more time, I could show you this very interesting video that the Rubin Foundation commissioned from the American Museum of Natural History for a cosmology and religion exhibition a few years ago, which moves out to the scope of the known universe, but starts and ends at Kailash. Kailash, the center of the center of the center, the center of the Himalaya. The Himalaya is the sort of the center of the civilizational project in which we associate ourselves. So Kailash now is central, And it has a different kind of edginess to it. And its edginess comes from it being, as Ashok Kailash mentioned, some people add the name Kailash to their name after going on the pilgrimage, the way Hajis do with Hajj. It has a different kind of an interest because it's a transboundary place. So even as it's central, it's also deeply precarious because it's in the convergent point or the point of contact between a number of different civilizations and geopolitical forces. In fact, my sense, reflecting on the experiences that I've had and have heard about from others, is that the people who are there are in three different countries at the same time. Some of them are in China, some of them are in Tibet, some of them are in India. Very few of them are in the same place. It's part of the interest of this sort of shared landscape that we've spoken about. So what's interesting to me as a religious studies person is the way in which Mount Kailash is being celebrated and sold as the center of the center of the center, as a place that is sacred to four world religions. We see in various promotional materials it's a place that 2 billion people or more want to go. You can just see the tourism operators salivating at the prospect and everybody else in horror at this. This is a place that before was powerful because you couldn't get there. Now it's a place that supposedly 2 billion people want to go. It isn't 2 billion people, not all Hindus, it's just Shaivites, not all Buddhists, just Tibetan Buddhists of a particular kind. But still, many people are interested in going there. But I'm interested in the way in which it plays in the Western imagination, the idea that there is some kind of a place in which all these traditions converge and come together. It is central but still inaccessible. It's defined now by its precarious transboundary politics, a place where contradictions are resolved, in which things that are disparate are somehow or other harmonized with each other. Both times that I went on the trip, I went with an eclectic international interdisciplinary group of travelers and learned a lot from them. We weren't going to any particular place. We weren't going to the Hindu Kailash. We weren't going to the Bon Tise. We weren't going to the Tibetan Buddhist Gang Rinpoche. We were going to this place in Tibet that was important to all of these people, which made us different from most of the people we saw, each of whom were there for a particular mountain. But we were all intensely interested in these people who were going to a single place. And we studied them, and we tried to speak to them, and we took photographs of them, and we videoed them, and we did all sorts of other things to try and get a sort of an unmediated experience of it as a single place. It's very interesting to me. We thought, many of us, that perhaps many of these other pilgrims would also be interested in other pilgrims who are actually traversing other mountains as part of other cosmogonies. My sense so far is that they were not there for that. We were there for that. They were not there for that. It was a different kind of an experience they were after. The second time I went, there were more artists in our group, so I learned more from the group. Also, it was a place that it was a little bit familiar to me, so I could watch myself watching it and watch other people engaging it in different ways. As I guess performers in the theater often say, I remember one of my best friends is a theater director, and I went to see one of her shows, and I said, I loved it, and she said, if you loved it, come back tomorrow night, it'll be completely different. Einmal ist keinmal. So I had the privilege of being there twice, so it was great. I learned a great deal from the way in which people who see differently, who are working in different directions, expressed, saw things, and then articulated and shared what they saw. I got a tremendous amount out of the Kailash Cartographies exhibit. I learned a lot about how to see and all the things that I had not seen, and I'm grateful to Luce, India China Institute, New School for making all this possible. In my own way as a scholar, I'm trying to share what I learned, but I'm having a hard time. As a scholar, I've been thinking about what a multi-religious mountain could be. Because I find myself putting the word sick after each one of these things. Like, what does religion mean? What does mountain mean? What does multi mean? But as I do it, I come across more and more interesting myths and hopes, as well as the distortions that come from speaking about world religions, as Ashok mentioned in the first place. I'm aware that my perspective is decisively not that of the people indigenous to the Kailash sacred landscape, or even intimate with it in their religious worlds. Instead, I'm indigenous to the fraught discourse of religious studies, an academic project in the United States, and also in comparative and theoretical studies more generally. And if I'm intimate with anything, it is with the ambivalence which we have towards terms, places, and traditions. I'm exploring these tensions, openings, and closures in a class that I'm teaching this semester at Lang with the coy title, Not to Scale on Sacred Mountains. Because if you didn't know, Kailash is not for scaling, it's for circumambulating. In its way, it's the course that I wish I had taken before I went, but I think that's true about many of the courses and books and things that we do, that there, I wish I'd known this when I started this project, and I haven't finished the course yet, but by the end of it, maybe I'll be where I wish I were at the beginning of it. In some way, though, however, it brings me back to where I started, a space here in Lower Manhattan where Kailash is a myth, somebody is telling somebody else about this mythical place, saying, it's real, I tell you. There's something to be learned from studying this, having some kind of a relationship, entering into some kind of an encounter with this place that you hadn't heard of or hadn't thought was a real object of encounter before. I'm discovering also that from this, the luxury of this place here at the New School, every mountain can be sacred. After my first trip, I was so appalled by the onslaught of future of tourism and future tourism that I imagined putting together an international campaign called If Kailash is important to you, don't go. This time, having violated my own advice, my thoughts are more complicated. Why should Kailash be important to us who don't live there? In what ways can Kailash be something that can be interesting to us in ways that doesn't expropriate it from those who do live there? Why should Kailash be important to anyone? And where do we go from there? So, thank you.
I'm Nitin Sahani. I'm at the School of Media Studies, and several of our alumni are here today, artists, practicing artists and filmmakers, and I'm really glad to see you all here. I'm also thankful to Ashok for bringing us all together for this project, and I'll talk a little bit about my experience working there more as a media ethnographer and a sound artist. So I'm going to play you sounds as I'm talking, and I hope it's not too distracting. We'll try to get the levels up. What you're hearing are did that just stop? So what you're hearing are sounds from the Buddha Nath, which is a very sacred site in Mount Kailash. It's interesting to say that. It's a very sacred site in Kathmandu, and it was my entry point into Kailash. For the Buddhists at least, these concepts are synchronous with each other. Kailash exists in many places. The notion of Kailash as a sacred place also exists in these Buddhist stupas. So circumambulating Buddha Nath is as good in many ways and as powerful for some people as circumambulating Kailash. So that's what I set to do one morning when I was in Kathmandu, was circumambulate for an hour. And as I was circumambulating, I was recording the sounds of the rising day, of the crows, the pigeons, the pilgrims, the devotees who were also circumambulating with me. Kathmandu, as many of you may have been, is a place of deep history, but also a place of traffic, chaos, and madness. And somehow Buddha Nath retains this sense of sanctity and peace throughout the day, especially in the early part of the day. So I was there with my sound recorder. I had been doing sound recordings for the last 9 days in Kathmandu, in various sites throughout Kathmandu. Some of these sites were visibly sacred sites, temples, monasteries, and some, I think we had to rethink what it meant to be sacred. The Bagmati River, for many people, is sacred, but today is quite polluted, and I spent time also walking along the Bagmati and recording the sounds of the Bagmati and the people who live around there. In each walk, I would sometimes walk alone, and I would sometimes walk with another Nepali or someone from the region, a writer, a poet, an artist, a sociologist, and just have a conversation with them. It was not an interview, it was just walking together, feeling each other's presence, and then having a conversation about what are we feeling, what are we seeing. So sometimes I'd walk with a writer, Robbie, who has written extensively about Kathmandu, both as a both as growing up as a child and its present day form. And we talk about childhood memories, both in my growing up in New Delhi and growing up in Kathmandu, and what it meant to conflate those. Here, as I was walking, I spent the first half hour walking alone and just really soaking in the atmosphere of the place. And I'm always walking with headphones on because I'm trying to amplify the experience, the sonic experience of that place. And with my the co-worker, sometimes I'd have them put on the headphones and ask them, what are you hearing? What are you seeing? Now, as you see, there's also people prostrating in the Bodhanath, as they do in Mount Kailash, and it's a very, it's quite a struggle to do so. But you also see people who don't have visual senses and are experiencing that place completely sonically. So this was a blind man who was spending his time there. He almost got hit by a truck at one point. Luckily, he survived. But everyone's experiencing this place with very different senses. Some of them are touching and feeling it viscerally through their tactile senses. And some of them are actually helping rebuild the place. So Kathmandu, as many of you know, 2 years ago was devastated by an earthquake. And many of these sites were partially destroyed, some totally destroyed. And these women were coming and volunteering their time and helping rebuild. Kaesang is a filmmaker who has been working in that region. He's of Tibetan origin. And halfway through my walk, he joined me and found me there. And we began talking about the cosmology of Buddhist thinking and the Bon approach to walking anti-clockwise. And we had a really good discussion about what it meant to do these walks and why it was important and what he sees as a filmmaker when he works in this region. As I was leaving Bodhanath, I was really touched by the stillness of a monk who was there, just really asking for an offering, which is unusual for monks. So, all of these sacred walks, I recorded 9 of them when I was in Kathmandu. I made a sort of visual installation of it. The point was to really stay in the sound. So if you go to this website, sacredsoundwalks.org, which I launched shortly after I came back last year, you can hear the raw sound recordings from each of those sound walks. There's 9 of them here. You also see a section of images. But what's interesting is this bit, which is the geolocated journeys that I took. I had a GPS tracker with me because I'm a runner and I track my runs for some odd reason. And I thought I'd try that in these sacred sites. And in this case, you see 13 circumambulations of the site, but you also see my heart rate. And you also see the pace with which I'm walking and the visceral experience I'm having at certain moments throughout that journey. I did that for all of the 9 sound walks. Interestingly, on the 10th one that I went to was the Mahabuddha temple that Ashok had told me to go to. I went with Jonathan Bach, whose mother-in-law was not well, and he wanted to go there to pray with her. I spent time there in a very sensitive moment for him. None of my gear was working. My GPS tracker, my heart rate monitor did not work in the Mahabuddha temple. For some reason, I was able to record the sounds of an old man chanting. And when I used whatever data I had from the GPS, it took me to the Indian Ocean. So it just, as an atheist, I really can't make sense of these events, but they certainly leave you with questions. I want to switch gears quickly to another soundtrack, which you are going to hear in the gallery. And what you're hearing now are sounds when I return back. Ashok somehow convinced me, as he did Mark, to return to the region. And I hadn't been to Kailash, but I was on my academic sabbatical, and I was like, well, I could be writing a book, or I could spend time in sacred mountains. We'll do the latter. And I spent, I guess, 30 days with many of you. Ruth and I were tent mates, so I got to know Ruth really well. And again, I was with my sound recorder. I would take a few sparse images, but I really wanted to feel the journey through a sonic experience. So in each of these places, I'm recording the sounds of the valleys, the winds, the sounds of the forest. And in this case, the cicades that live in the forest and the kinds of sounds they make. I did 27 field recordings, all of which I began to listen to over and over. But I gave my field recordings to a sound designer, a sound engineer, Jerry, who also works with classical Indian music and electroacoustic drum and bass music, and I asked him to just work with them and create a collage. So he created a 17-minute collage, which you're hearing here, which interweaves layers of these sounds with each other. So here we're hearing sounds of horses walking along, carrying some of our tents, and intermixed with them, you'll begin to hear sounds of chanting of monks in the many monasteries that we were. The sound you're hearing is by a woman who traveled with us for most of our 30-day trek. And at one point, at one of the highest points where there was fog all around and rocks that looked like little stupas, she sat down and began singing. We were all mesmerized, and I began recording her sounds. It's her form of devotion at that very sacred place. And as we continued, we went to half a dozen monasteries. Many of them have nearly passed and have been reinvigorated, but their traditions are dying, and their forms of chanting and sound making are dying. So just recording those was a privilege, to get up early in the morning and spend time with the monks and hear them chanting. Each one was very different. We did find our way to Kailash, the goat's head, as Mark likes to think. I had many different visions of it, but I was also trying to translate it through the sounds of Kailash. And Kailash doesn't have one sound, but is a mixture of many, many sounds. Kailash was also considered the place where Shiva rests, and he's also considered the maker of sounds of the universe, the creator of the universe. So it embodies, in many ways, the sounds of the universe in one place. So you can't really characterize Kailash with one sound. In a sense, the soundscape that I'm presenting embodies the journey of going to Kailash and has many of those sounds embodied in it. So this is one of the pilgrims, a Tibetan sort of elderly person who is well known in his community, and he spent time with us and he meditated in front of Kailash. Sounds of the water in Kailash. And curiously, the drum, Shiva's drum, I found it right at the base of the mountain for some odd reason. Maybe he left it behind in a hurry. So how do you then work with all this material? Clearly there's an ethnographic research process of making sense of these sounds and what they mean to people locally, and one could listen to those and discuss those. But then what do you do with them as an artist to bring them back to this gallery? So this show that Rith curated, which we'll tell you more about, I was watching it with Kira the other day, and I was explaining to her our journey of going there, and visually we could see Kevin's video piece of the horses that were walking through that area. But without the sounds of the horses' bells, the experience would be very different. The sounds added a very important component to it. So I decided to make my piece entirely sound-based. And what you see in the gallery, if you've had a chance to go, is a kind of circle of salt, a Himalayan salt, which happens to be from Pakistan, but it is a proxy for the salt that the yaks would carry, Pakistani Himalaya, transnational project. I got it from San Francisco, by the way. I didn't carry it with me. But we got four pounds of it to bring to the gallery. You see 2 pounds there. So that you could walk on it and feel what it means to experience that place. Salt was a very important part of the trade between the Tibetans and the Nepali tribes in those areas. And so here you see me doing a walk in the early stages of when I had set it up. And it was very meditative for me personally, as I'd been doing it. And so you're hearing the two soundtracks, one after the other, and you can either walk clockwise or anti-clockwise, whatever your faith is, or whatever your sensory rhythm is. Then I began walking with friends, with people who would come visit us in the gallery. It's a storm who decided to come walk with me on that day. And obviously, we tried to see how many people we could fit in that little circle. And I think the we hit about 6 at some point. I wanted to get to 7. So we have a few days left. We can hit this mark. And it's a very different experience with many people, with kind of, because what we were doing in Kailash was walking together, 15 to 20 of us, experiencing this place together. And so it's not a simulacra of that, but it is a different representation of that. We found a way to bring Kailash to New York, at least one aspect of that experience. There's Stephanie, who was brave enough to walk with me in one particular moment, and we had a Facebook live recording of the walk. And then curiously, as we were walking that day, Stephanie and I, a woman walked in from outside the gallery. She was in New York for just a day. She saw us walking with her partner, and she immediately came in and said, "Are you walking Kailash?" Like, "Yes, we are." She was like, "Well, I was in Kailash in 1987, 30 years ago, and I had such a visceral experience of being there." She, as she walked with us, she remembered all those memories of her visit to Kailash, and it was extraordinary being with her. So in a sense, I think, and I'm going to end here, the journey is both sensory exploration of Kailash. It's a research project of capturing sounds, of building a repository of soundscapes. But it's also a very spiritual experience of walking together and re-experiencing Kailash in a very different way. So I'll leave it there.
I think while Ashok was talking, you actually looked at me for about 20 minutes up on the screen. So I really am going to keep it short. You don't need to look at me for longer. Can you hear me okay? So I'm a political scientist by trade, by background, which makes me an odd fit for a project on religion and ecology. But my interest is in the politics of the environment, global governance. And so my sort of first point of connection with this project had to do with issues surrounding World Heritage status. Some of you, you know, may know that the Kailash is on its way, perhaps, to a nomination as a World Heritage Site, which is a UNESCO program that would designate it, give a certain status, perhaps increase the already growing number of people who are coming there, both as tourists and as pilgrims. And so something I looked at in my past research was, you know, the ways that different categories of World Heritage impinge on and affect and construct certain sites in certain ways. And the evolution of a category like sacred landscape or cultural landscape with sacred values is actually a fairly recent innovation within UNESCO's own institutional history that comes out of, in fact, sort of an inability to recognize and engage with sites where there's not a tangibly built infrastructure in place, right? So in the past, World Heritage would really engage with monuments, with built monuments, built sites on the one hand, right? Churches, you know, the Eiffel Tower. And on the other hand, you'd have natural areas, wilderness areas that were preserved, or areas with threatened biodiversity. And so this sort of category of cultural landscape was created in the 90s and used by UNESCO to start to gesture to situations where there is a more associative element or an intangible element. And so in some sense, when you look at some of the images here, if you look at the image in the gallery that Kevin Bubrisky did, right, of the pilgrims prostrating. What heritage would seek to preserve in that context is not the mountain itself, right? The mountain itself is not what's being designated as heritage, nor is it the culture in a sense of the interactions among people. It's the relationship between people and mountain, and that exists in a strange sort of a space. It doesn't have a physical sort of existence to it in a clear way. So part of what I was interested in this project was, you know, what would it mean to preserve a sacred landscape with associative elements, with intangible sorts of elements, as heritage? What does it mean to fix something that is in many ways a living, an ongoing tradition, an ongoing production? What does it mean to think of that as heritage, which suggests that it is something sort of past, right? There's something more fixed about heritage. So that's, you know, part of the work I've done is sort of in that sort of policy space, thinking about what that would mean in this site. And visiting gives you an entirely different encounter with that question. And so the field work there, is in part sort of a contextual kind of field work, but it allows you to really see and understand questions around a sacred landscape as it's actually lived and materialized in a certain context. And for me, that was a really invaluable sort of spur, I guess, to thinking about heritage, not just out of the realm of policy and texts, where I'm generally quite happy, but to see it as a policy option that has very material consequences. A couple other things that struck me as quite interesting, and one has to do with the way that this area, as a political scientist, the geopolitical issues are sort of the first thing that jumped to mind, and it's a very geopolitically contested area, and that's something that we encountered again in the field work, right, in a very personal sort of a way, in crossing borders, in certain kinds of access issues, seeing the highly securitized elements that are present in the region, really across all three countries. One way to sort of think about this space is as, three countries with certain interests who are trying to understand how they might engage in this space in a cooperative sort of a way. There are boundary disputes, right, in a number of places. There are territorial disputes. There's a really fascinating, to me, a tri-corner boundary. It's a really unique sort of intersection of states, which creates different kinds of incentives and interests. And so for a sacred landscape, right, there's awful lot of politics and security at work. So when you say sacred landscape, in a sense, it sort of, washes over that sort of geopolitical aspect. But on the other hand, there are also a lot of elements here that are transnational, right? And so you might think about this not as a space of geopolitics, but as a space of transnational politics as well. And that's something that, for me, came out of the visit to the region. So I didn't know before going of the kinds of cultural ties that people have across this region, across all three countries. The way that these go back in history and in some ways have been cut off by the imposition of national borders. The kinds of shared ecological conditions that people have, again, across these three countries in sharing a mountainous space, dealing with issues of water access, right, and with springs drying up, and to think about how this will change, right, under accelerating conditions of climate change, to think about the agricultural kinds of activities that are in play here, and what it means to make a living and indeed live in this region, because if it is a sacred landscape in that sense, it's not only sacred for people from distant centers, right, of major religions, but it's also sacred in this sort of everyday sense that we were working with in this project. That's a very different kind of a sacred, and it implies, I think, a different kind of a politics. So it's this intersection of the transnational and the geopolitical, right, that for me I found really fascinating. A big part of this came, as a number of other people have said, a big part of the interest for me in this project came in sharing the field work, both with people from multiple disciplines, right, which we do at the New School, a lot, but to do it in a sustained way with a singular sort of focus, I think was really generative for me and has led to some openings for me in the kinds of classes that I teach, the kind of work that I do. But also sharing with scholars from the three countries themselves, right? So to be able to go on this trip to Kailash with Shekhar Pathak, who's a historian from India, retired from JNU. He's walked more miles in the Himalayas than I've probably walked in my entire life. He spent his life, walking through these spaces, talking to people who live there. There's a really sort of deep understanding that comes from there. Colleagues from Tibetan China, right, from Nepal. So it's both international and interdisciplinary, and that sort of leads to this wonderful melange, right, and mixture of ideas. Confusing at times, and then eventually sort of sorts itself out into, I think, a more interesting and nuanced understanding of the place. So in terms of, its impact on me, I mean, it has really moved me in a couple ways, both in terms of research and teaching, and then I'll just wrap up after this. I'm quite interested now in mountain governance, so the emergence of mountains, not as specific sorts of sites of governance only, although certainly that's at work here in Kailash, but the emergence of mountains more broadly in a global context as sort of new global policy objects, right? So we're very used to thinking and talking about global climate as a singular sort of entity, perhaps global biodiversity, Increasingly global forests, global deserts. There's these sort of return of geographical objects, right, to the forefront of policy thinking. And I think mountains are sort of a new, you know, a new frontier, if there are frontiers left, in that. And it's a very interesting, and I think it's not entirely positive, right? But on the other hand, there are possibilities within that that I want to explore more. And to do that, I'm interested in you know, using Kailash as one of a number of sites within which we might think through some of the politics and problematics of using mountains as this global category for governance. The other thing it's led to has been a new class called the Politics of Walking. Walking is very central to this, right, to Kailash as pilgrimage. Again, politically speaking, I'm also interested in walking as a collective kind of activity, in what ways it can bring people together. But not only in a way that is about sacredness or about you know, or about religion, right? But also in a sort of lived sense of constraining mobility. So a lot of what we saw was not just people walking, but people not being allowed to walk. So who was allowed to be a pilgrim, right, at the border crossing, for example? Who was allowed to go through and circumambulate was a question. How did the local residents of the area, where were they allowed to walk? When? Did they want to walk? Many wanted roads, right? The walking is not a great thing for everyone. What does that look like in the context of these larger questions about heritage, politics, and policy, and environmental governance that I'm looking at? So this class, in any case, it looks both at walking as sort of an object of political research, but I've also opened up to walking as a kind of research practice. And so I'm sending my students out into the city with recording sounds and trying to think, you know, more about what does it mean to walk and understand a place through your embodied experience of it. And it, you know, that this has a really, you know, sort of good connection back to the pilgrimage and you know, the work we did here. It's been really generative, and thanks for listening.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for sticking around. My name is Shrestha Rit Premnath. I'm a faculty in the Fine Art program at Parsons. And I'm very happy to be involved with this project. And I want to thank Ashok Gurung, Chris Cruz, Basang Sherpa, who isn't with the India-China Institute any longer, but was very central to a lot of the project that I was involved with, and of course to the Luce Foundation for making it all happen and for funding it. I wanted to very quickly sketch out for you how the show came about. Radhika Subramaniam, who couldn't be here today and who's the director of the SJDC Gallery, had invited me to go to a meeting at the India-China Institute. I thought it was some organization in New York, and I said, sure. And then when I saw the address, I realized it was in the New School. And all of a sudden, I realized there was this whole resource that seemed so important in a school where students from Asia form a very major, large population. And myself, coming from India, having grown up in India, it seemed like an important institution and resource to become involved with. And so Radhika and I, in collaboration with Ashok, started to think about how this Sacred Landscapes initiative could have a kind of branch that dipped into art and humanities. And it was something that Ashok had already started working with some artists in Kathmandu. And so this was a project that the two of us, Radhika and I, entered into. And the first way in which we extended this project was to convene a meeting in Shimla with a group of artists from India, China, and Nepal, and of course, the US. We were coming from the New School. And Shimla became the place that we decided to meet because, as Nitin said, that was the year that there was a major earthquake in Kathmandu where we'd initially planned to meet. This meeting became very generative. It was a place where we talked about these kind of complex issues around landscape, sacredness, and ecology that Mark and Rafi have laid out for you. But as a group of artists, although we kind of forged friendships and started kind of a deep discussion around the topic, We felt that the next step would be to meet and actually try to make something, that we'd been sitting together for 10 days and talking, and we'd kind of gotten stir crazy. And so a year later, we, again, thanks to Ashok, were able to convene a meeting and something akin to a workshop in Kathmandu. And this is Ravi Thapa, who is the co-editor of Lalit, which is a publication that you'll see in the exhibition. And Ravi and Ashmina Ranjit, who's an artist who's also in the exhibition, became the kind of artist guides who led us through the city, showed us around, and kind of grounded us both sort of politically, historically, geographically, and in a way gave us an anchor from which to start a whole set of projects. Ashok, Dina Bangdel, who is an art historian and art educator, who again served as one of these guides, and Atul Bhalla, a very important artist from New Delhi, India, who was with us and who's in the show. And so this was a very generative meeting. A lot of projects, including the one Nithin described, his walking around Badanath Stupa, my series of sleeping dogs that are in the exhibition, Ashmina Ranjit and Radhika Subramanyam's walks, which are documented in very different ways in the show. And it was with this kind of experience of having thought about Kailash in the abstract that Ashok's invitation to literally go to Kailash came. And my first name is Shrestha, which to Americans doesn't mean anything, but to Nepali people means a lot. They keep thinking that I'm Nepali because it's a very common Nepali surname. In fact, people in the airport just would start speaking to me in Nepali. And I would say, no, I'm from South India. And they would say, no, you're not. So it was interesting. And my house, the house that I grew up in Bangalore, was named Manasarovar, which is the lake at the bottom of Kailash. And so this place has sort of haunted me in a way. And it was kind of an incredible experience, one that I cannot put into words in a minute. But well, it introduced me in a way, in this very haptic, tactile way, to a landscape that I had been in before. I had trekked in the Himalayas from middle school through high school every summer. And in some ways, as an atheist, my first sort of religious experiences or spiritual experiences really were in this relation with the sacred. And so I was keen to go and experience it once again, and it was incredible, as I had expected. And here are some pictures again. And so out of this experience, both of a kind of intellectual and artistic aesthetic engagement with ideas around landscapes and sacredness and ecology, and then a kind of lived sensorial bodily experience of being exhausted but awed by the tremendous beauty of a place at the same time, there's something about those two ways of being with that I think fill out one's idea of what these relationships mean. And I think in some ways Bo Zhang's piece in the exhibition, Bo, who had spoken during the opening of the exhibition, thinks through this kind of libidinal bodily relationship with nature. And so with that, I won't go into descriptions of each piece because my timer just went off, but also because there's a text that you can read and you can quite literally experience the work, and I'm here, so if you have questions, I'm more than happy to answer them. Thank you very much.